Gaming is an interactive medium, particularly by way of the manipulation of simulated or implied physical bodies. In order to do so, these bodies must be placed in simulated or implied physical environments to provide the player with the required spatial information to make informed decisions in order to justify their inputs. To oversimplify, video games occur in places, and player interaction within those places are often informed by our cultural understanding of our own environment. To explore this concept, I propose EcoGaming, a comprehensive video series exploring the myriad ways players are interpolated to view our own environment through gaming. Given the sheer number of video games out there, surely we'll find something interesting to talk about, right? The first leg of our journey tackles the problematic concept of wilderness, a concept still utilized by a great number of digital interactive experiences. The term wilderness itself comes from the Old English wilderness, meaning land inhabited by wild beasts. This linguistic delineation suggests a distinction between lands for animals and lands for humans, and that in some way these two spaces are separate. This sentiment can be seen in some of the oldest ancestors of our literary heritage. For example, the epic poem Beowulf follows the exploits of the eponymous hero as he attempts to vanquish monsters, in a stereotypically Anglo-Saxon mixture of boasting and extreme violence, of course. In the first section of the poem, Beowulf is invited to the Great Hall of King Hrothgar. There, he learns that a monster known as Grendel has been sneaking into the hall at night from the surrounding woods, breaking in and eating Hrothgar's best warriors in their sleep. Grendel is an imposing figure, and not just because he's described as ferocious. To an 8th century English audience, the Great Hall represented the bastion of civilization. It was where trading, eating, resting, and storytelling took place, and was the safest place to be in a very dangerous world. To have that space invaded by an agent of nature was a pretty frightening thing, so much so that Grendel has been an evocative figure of pop culture to this very day. The important thing to recognize from this legacy is that the environment for humans and the environment for animals are not just clear and distinct from one another, but are often diametrically opposed. This opposition has proven to be a typical mode of environmental representation in video games. To examine this, let's take a look at the most innocuous example possible: Minecraft. Minecraft is a three-dimensional sandbox game that, by way of the mechanics, encourages players to build items and structures from resources harvested from the environment. When a player first begins, they are dropped into a completely uncultivated world. Unless playing on the peaceful difficulty, the world has a number of creatures that come out during the evening, so players are encouraged to quickly set up a place of dwelling. This is likely the first step players will accomplish when beginning the game, as without a shelter, the player will be killed by the entities of this digital ecology. However, in doing so, the player begins to draw their line in the sand, so to speak, that line separating their space from that of the environment. In order to better establish their home base from the outside world, players must gather increasingly rare and difficult to acquire materials, creating a cyclical process of expedition, extraction, and construction. In many cases, players prefer to create outposts in order to streamline resource stockpiling and processing, resulting in a form of, essentially, environmental colonization. And because the world is endlessly procedurally generated, once one area's resources are exhausted, a player need only travel to a new one to begin the process again. Even in games that critique this cycle, the player is usually encouraged to follow the very same methodology. The beginning of Fallout 4 illustrates a world in which 1950s America's speculative science fiction became a reality. But remember what the intro said?
But then, in the 21st century, people awoke from the American dream. Years of consumption led to shortages of every major resource. The entire world unraveled. Peace became a distant memory.
Which is to say, full-blown nuclear war. The game takes place 200 years after that war, and the player comes face-to-face with surviving in an irradiated Boston. Much like Minecraft, the player falls into a cycle: go out, kill a bunch of indigenous people or creatures, loot the space for valuable goods, build up the player's arsenal and home base, and repeat. Despite explicitly critiquing this habitual consumption of natural resources, the game champions this process as the only acceptable way to engage with the environment and succeed. Any way you cut it, these patterns of interaction can be problematic. The mechanics enforce a ritualistic exploitation of the environment. Because the environment is portrayed as this place apart from human dwelling, the harvesting of natural resources is never questioned or critiqued. There is no mechanical or narrative aspect experienced during play to dissuade players from practices that are essentially strip mining and deforestation. Wilderness, in this and many games like it, is a literal place apart, in which human activity has no bearing on ecological and environmental frameworks. Countless games follow this structure, ranging from the resource extraction and genocide of wildlife in World of Warcraft through the explicitly imperialistic Civilization series. Do I even need to mention Pokemon? The environment in the vast majority of games simply exists to further anthropocentric interests. But what are some other ways games present the environment? Surely not all games follow this destructive pattern. In my next video, I'll be explaining another primary mode of environmental interaction that recently took the industry by storm, the pastoral.